Hi, is anyone there? Am I live? I'm a bit early, just before 6:30, but I'm just checking to see, am I live? And can you read the writing that's on this television behind me? I want to see, am I in mirror or am I the right way up? Hi, seeing. Nice to see you. Hi, Rebecca. Can somebody tell me, Sally, hiya, can you tell me, is the writing on this television the right way up? Or are you seeing it in mirror? Could somebody please just give me a thumbs up? I am live, yep. Can you see the television the right way up? Can you read what's on my screen? Yes, crystal clear, says somebody. Hooray, fantastic. Great. We'll just wait for 1 minute, see if anybody else joins, and then we'll be good to go. Great to see everyone. Hope you're having a good week. And I'm all set with my cups. Don't worry if you haven't got cups, it's not a problem, but we'll be doing a cup game, funnily enough. So I think we're just going to get started, folks. Tonight is the first of three little sessions on what is Kodai-inspired music education. And it's one of those, I teach Kodai, and I always think, wonder what people actually mean by I teach Kodai, because Kodai was a person, a composer. I don't teach Kodai, I teach music. I have to say though, I teach music in a very Kodai-inspired way. So for me, that's the most important thing, that we teach this philosophical way in a Kodai-inspired way, but we all, at the end of the day, teach music. So tonight and for the next two Tuesdays, I just want to talk a bit about what is meant by Kodai-inspired music education. If I were to summarize it in one word, and actually if Kodai were asked, when Kodai was asked to summarize in one word, he said the one word was singing. And I think that's absolutely fundamental to the whole approach, musicianship training through singing. So we have to start with singing. I'm going to sing, you're going to be my echo. It's an African song, and if you've been watching the warm-ups, you'll be aware of what the song is. Hey Unguwa. Hey, 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 Unguwa. Hey, 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 Unguwa. Hey, 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 Unguwa. Unguwa, Unguwa. Very easy song, there's only one word, hey Unguwa, so not much text to worry about. And given that we're going live all over the world, I thought that was quite important actually. Simple text. Let's have one more go. Hey, 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 hey Unguwa. Hey, 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 hey Unguwa. Hey, 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 hey Unguwa. Unguwa, Unguwa. Fantastic. What better way to start a Kodai session than singing? So why did Kodai feel that singing was the most important thing? A number of reasons. One, it's free. That's got to be a good thing in music education today. Two, and more importantly, we're all born with a voice. We all have the ability to sing. And three, crucially for me, as a pre-instrumental musicianship training, singing is absolutely fundamental. The ability to hear in your head what you're about to play on your instrument, whatever that instrument may actually be. The ability to hear it first before you play something is crucial. So singing, the fundamental root for me of musicianship training. Hey Unguwa was our fabulous song. Kodai inspired education divides into three separate, very distinct areas, I guess I would call them. His philosophical ideas about music education and how music education should be taught. And the philosophical ideas we'll talk about more as the weeks go on. the tools of the Kodai method, and I put that in big inverted commas because we don't really like the word method. We think of it more as a Kodai inspired way, a Kodai philosophy. But the teaching tools that Kodai promoted were the use of solfa names, hand signs, rhythm names, none of which he himself created. So I suppose some people call him like the magpie. He took things from other people. He promoted the use of these things because he saw those tools work in other places. And the third area, I guess, is the misconception area, I would call it, the pedagogical tricks, things that teachers have created over years that are somehow now called Kodai ideas, but actually they're not Kodai ideas at all. So for example, tonight I'll be playing a cup game. Somebody has said to me, my children love the Kodai cups. They are not Kodai cups. Actually, I think they're from IKEA. But Kodai didn't create the cups nor the cup games. Over years, things have been adapted and teachers have put their own personal slant on things or have created things to appeal to 21st century children. So actually the children that I teach today in the Kodai inspired way are very different children to the children I taught many years ago. And we have to adapt things as we go. So the pedagogical tricks that teachers have created to lead us along the pathway in Kodai education, but the destination remains the same, high quality music education founded in Kodai's principles. So tonight, actually, the tools are the thing that I want to work on first. Some of you may well be aware of what those tools are and use them regularly, and some people may not be aware of them at all. But I want to talk about the tools of the trade tonight, and we'll think about the other things as we go. Kodai inspired education works in a very simple way as regards the tools, that the children need to hear the sound before they see the symbol. So actually what we do is fill the children's head with sounds and then show them what the symbol is. And actually, I always feel that this is very akin to reading, hence the reason I put three little children reading there. Before those three children managed to read that the text in that book they look at, they had to hear the sounds of the language, the sounds of their mother tongue. So as a baby's born into the world, they hear the sounds of the mother tongue. They then learn how those sounds are put together to form words, and only then do they learn to read the text on the page. And the Kodai way of teaching is a bit similar to the way we learn to read text. First we hear the sounds, and then we learn how those sounds are put together to form intervals, and then we learn what it looks like on the page. So it's actually very logical. We prepare those sounds by filling the child's head with music. We fill the child's head with the correct songs and the correct rhymes that will prepare them for the introduction of music notation, rhythm notation, pitch notation. And if the preparation is done well and the child has a bank of the best songs to teach any given concept, then it will be successful. And I say that with 100% confidence because I've seen the results of good Kodai teaching over many years. But if the sound isn't prepared in the child's head well, then it falls apart. So this preparation stage is absolutely crucial to the success of this methodology. We then present the concept to the child when the time is right. And people say, how long do you have to prepare before we present the fact that it's a crotchet and two quavers or whatever we present? How long's a piece of string? It depends on the children, it depends how long their daily music lesson is, their weekly music lesson is, their monthly music lesson is. Who knows? It all depends. Actually, I always think of it when there's nothing more to tell the child except the name of the concept, then probably all the preparation has actually been done. Then comes possibly the hardest stage of all, the practice stage, when the child's been introduced to the concept, They then need to practice it. And we all know that the practice stage can be the toughest of all. And it's up to us as educators, music educators, to make that practice something that's engaging, something inspiring, and something that will help the child to keep on board with us as we work together on our musical journey. Let's have a look at this preparation stage now. Here's a very simple song. Oh, once a man fell in the well, splish, splash, splosh he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. Here come the dreaded cups. So we're going to learn a little pattern now. If you don't have cups there while you're watching, just tap along and you can have a practice with the real cups later on, but you'll get the gist of the game. So, here I go, once a man fell in the well, splish, splash, splosh he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. I'm trying so carefully to keep those cups in the frame of that picture and not let them fly off the edge. I'll try one more time. Oh, once a man fell in the well, splish, splash, splosh he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. So the game actually is practicing the feeling of the rhythm ta and tete before we introduce that to children. Te, 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 te. Sorry, te, 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 ta. And the children will absorb that feeling of the rhythm. They will understand it better. They'll have a deeper understanding. So this preparation isn't just of the song itself. If we can find a way to practice the rhythmic element as well, through a game, through some other way, but they should experience the rhythm in body movement in some way before we introduce them to the notation. Let's have one more go. Off you go, once a man fell in the well, splish, splash, splosh he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. So this preparation leads us to have the child feel the rhythm. They're going to see the rhythm, and actually they've kind of seen it here in a way. They've seen the movement, and of course they've heard the rhythm through the lyrics of the text. The text in children's song frequently will give us the rhythm, because very few children's songs are melismatic. They usually have one syllable per sound. The children need to know, however, one fundamental thing, and I've seen so many mistakes in Coda-inspired education where there's a big rush to get the child to read ta, which is the name for a crotchet, and titi, which is the name for two quavers. And actually, teachers sometimes introduce the symbol ta and titi, and the children read it but don't actually align the beat and rhythm together. It frequently aligns something like that. Titi, 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 ta. And actually, that's not what we want children to do, as I'm sure you will all agree. So they have to know how do the beat and the rhythm align so that it becomes something like that, as it should be. How do we get them to align that beat and rhythm together? Normally, I would have them walk on the floor, four floor spots, round circle spots, and they would walk the beat and be clapping the rhythm at the same time, so they can see how does it align. If we don't have the floor spots, we can use our fingers, and we can do, oh, once a man fell in the well, and show them in the beat. Sorry if I got that back to front, it's that mirror image thing. Show them on our fingers how that all aligns. The beat, our fingers, the rhythm in tapping. So find some way to marry those two things together so that the children can actually read this thing. And then comes, we present the name of that thing. And if I'm being honest, I don't normally present it in this way, that the notation would be shown first to the children. Actually, I want the children to feel the rhythm and show it in a more child-friendly way. So I'm going to kind of sit in front of that thing now, because that's not the most important thing for the children at this stage. I want them to feel, and they will have seen when they walk the spots, that the beat subdivides into two sounds or one sound. And when there's only one sound on a beat, I want them to show me like this. And when there's two sounds on a beat, the beat, the one sound divides into two. So here's our one sound, here's our two. And we can show it from one side of our body to the other side, representing the beats. So, once a man fell in a well, would be shown as dee, 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 ta. Why is this stage important? This stage of playfulness. And in this lockdown, non-contact world that we live in at the moment, this way is actually quite useful, because they don't have to hold or touch another child. Another way to do it is a beautiful way, and I really love for the younger children, that they share a spot together and they hold out their hand and they're best friends, and they show by shape, person, person, and they hold on to each other. But in this non-contact world, this is quite a nice substitute. And actually, for some children, physical contact is an issue anyway. So in practicing this way, we can show that they know where does the beat live and what actually happens on the beat. So the next phrase of our song, splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. Splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. It's kind of like instant dictation. Oh, that horrible, dreadful word that we were all petrified of when we were all at music college. Dictation. Take out your pencils and write. Actually, it was pretty terrifying. And I certainly was one of those people who had this horrible lump in my throat at the thought, here comes dictation, and I'm so bad at dictation. Actually, we need to teach dictation. I think we've taught musical children for many years, and if any musical child will probably just get it anyway. They'll understand that thing. But if we break it all down and make it achievable in this playful way, then it becomes a tool that's accessible to all children. And I think that for all of us in music education has to be our goal, that music education isn't just for the musical child. Music education is for every child. And that's something that I think hasn't necessarily happened in our country, or potentially all over the world. So break it down and make it playful, make it something that children can actually understand and access. And then the logical step from this to this to this on the board is quite simple, because they've seen that one sound is just like this one sound at the end here, and two sounds joined together is just like this here. But if you're a dyslexic child, jumping straight to this might well be an issue for you, but this might not be. So again, it's a way to encourage and engage every single child in the activity. So here's the rest of our song. And of course, we could say all those rhythm names now, because we're experts already. Say the rhythm with me. Ready, steady, off we go. Dee, 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 da. Dee, 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 da, ta. Dee, 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 ta. Dee, 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 ta, ta. Fabulous. Simple as that, simple as reading ABC. So when we've introduced children to that thing, these names, how do we then practice it? That becomes a more challenging thing for us. We have to practice it in all of these ways here, The children should be reading those rhythms first from the material that's known, the material that's in their song bank in their head, and from composition, from improvising, from making sure we write those rhythms. And the writing can be with a pencil. It could be that the children actually write a rhythm for us to clap back for them in this way, because in this way they're still composing, but it's a kind of more child friendly way. And in listening, can they recognise those patterns in carefully chosen material that we give them as listening activities? So for example, Titi and Ta, the Hall of the Mountain King. Ti-ti-ti-ti-ti-ti-ta, ti-ti-ta, ti-ti-ta, can very easily be a listening and recognition activity. So making sure the practice stage encompasses all of those different activities to keep the child engaged and have a deeper level of understanding, more importantly. What does that mean with once a man fell in a bell, in a well even, not a bell, once a man fell in a well? Are we done with that song? Can we now put it in the trash? Or can we recycle it? Actually, a very good song in Kora inspired education, and in any musical education for me, a good song is one that has multiple uses. Because if the song is embedded in the child's head, we can bring that song back again at a later date and do something with it. So once a man fell in a well should absolutely not go in the trash. It should go in the recycling bin. What can we do with that song? We can introduce melodic shape. Very good song for melodic shape because it's moving by step. We can introduce canon. We can invert the song and sing it in its upside down version. We can transform it into minor later. We can teach the new pitch fa when the pentatonic scale has been mastered. So mi re do. Then fa will just slot in nicely. We usually, in Kodai work, we teach the pentatonic scale first because fa and ti, the semitones, are the most difficult to tune. But if we have a sound knowledge of the pentatonic scale, then this is an excellent song for just dropping in this new pitch fa if the sound is already prepared in the child's head. So let's sing this song now, showing the melodic shape. Just in hand levels, not in hand signs, just show the shape. Off you go, once a man fell in the well. Splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. And we could actually, I'll just move this little table out of the way. We could actually show this in body percussion, that we do a stamp for the lowest note. Once a man fell in a well. Let's have a go at showing it in that way. A stamp, a tap of the knees, a clap, then our shoulders, then our head. And in doing it in this way, then it's a greater body movement. And again, more embedded learning. Off you go, once a man fell in a well. Splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. I think my dog even joined in there. I don't know if you heard her, but I think she joined in too. Let's try a tiny bit faster. Off we go, once a man fell in the well. Splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. We can then, of course, sing the song in canon. So you could come in after, once a man fell, once a man fell. 2 beats later, you come in. I'll start, you come in canon. Here I go, once a man fell in a well. Splish, splash, splash, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. Why don't we do it in canon, but we'll add our body percussion part? I'm going to start. You come in at the same place. Here I go. Once a man fell in the well. Splish, splash, splash, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. And if we do it with the body percussion, we can then have a bash at coming in canon with ourselves. So obviously we can't sing in two parts. Well, maybe some of you can, but I'm desperate to hear. But if we record one part, clearly we can. But we can now do the canon so that we sing and then the body percussion part comes in canon with our singing. Will we have a try? Off we go. Once a man fell in the well. Splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. And I think I got the rhythm on my head wrong. But you know, our great friend Richard Michael says, mistakes are cool. Let's have one more go and I'll try and get it right. How was it? Did it work? Off we go. Once a man fell in the well. Splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. What's the point of what we're trying to do here? The point isn't to make some demon exercise that was just such a big challenge for children that they'll never get it right. Because believe me, children rise to challenges really, really well. And actually, children are almost more coordinated than we are as adults. So the challenge is, or the goal is, that actually when we come in with the second part in canon, that we're actually hearing the pitch of that second part. So I'm singing, once a man fell, and I'm singing in the well, but I'm hearing two. So I'm hearing that interval, the starting pitch there, and the pitch I'm on. And that polyphonic hearing, developing the ability to do that ourselves, is a really crucial skill that we hear harmonically and not just sing our own melodic line. The transformation exercise comes, of course, much, much later when children are aware of different pentachordal scales and they can change. Once a man fell in the well, they can go to their relative minor. Once a man fell in the well, and they can play around with all of this song. The inversion, the kind of mirror image of that thing, of course they can turn every single line of that melody on its head. Once a man fell in the well, splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. Why don't you try doing the upside down version? And I'll do the right way up. Ready, steady, off you go. Once a man fell in the well. Splish, splash, splosh, he sounded. If he had not fallen in, he would not have drowned. Play around with that one. It's a great song. But hopefully you can see why we wouldn't throw it in the recycle bin when we've used it simply to introduce the rhythm names. Here's another little song. Good News Chariot's Coming. Actually, this is a warm up this week too, so maybe you'll be ahead of the game. The song goes like this. Good news, chariot's coming. Good news, chariot's coming. Good news, chariot's coming. Don't leave me behind. And I can really sit in front of this television now because you don't need to see it anyway, really. You just need to see the actions. Here I go. Good news, chariot's coming. Good news, chariot's coming. Good news, chariot's coming. Don't leave me behind. Have you got the actions? So the actions are following, just like we did in Once a Man Fell in a Well, the actions are actually following the melodic shape. First three lines coming in just after the beat. Let's have another go. Good news, chariot's coming. Good news, chariot's coming. Good news, chariot's coming. Don't leave me behind. So we would play this game with the children, and we could put some of those pitches, of course, in our head. Let's say every time we clap our hands, we're not allowed to sing out loud. Only here. Off we go, good news, char coming, char coming, good news, char coming, me hind. I'll leave you to work on that one. But what are we really embedding in the child's head? We're embedding those three pitches. Do, do, do. And for older children, I would always start the pitch reading with Do Re Mi for older children. For younger children, I would start with So and Mi. But for the older children, I feel, and I've tried over years now to both ways, I feel for the older children, Mi Re and Do is more their world. They live in a kind of tonal centered world. Their pop music they'll be listening to will come home to Do. It won't be centered around So Mi. More importantly, if they are instrumentalists, then no instrument will actually start, I don't think, with So Mi interval. Most instrumental learning will begin with Do Re Mi or string playing, Do to So, open fifth. So Kodai didn't say start with So Mi, and it's one of the misconceptions, I think, that we have to start with So Mi because Kodai said. Actually, Kodai didn't teach children. Kodai's disciples created this methodology. And Kodai himself believed that we should start with what's appropriate in our country, what's appropriate in our repertoire, that the folk songs of our nation should be the guiding light as to what we actually, how we sequence the learning. Actually, in Britain, there's a lot of So Mi songs for very young children, but they're kind of feel nursery baby songs. Ring a ring a roses, na 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 na. Feels as if it's for younger children and works beautifully for younger children. So if I'm working with the younger children, that's my starting point always. But when I'm working with the older children, this is my starting point. So let's have a go at Good News Chariot's Coming. It only uses these three pitches, Mi, Re and Do. Oh, that's cool. You're kind of seeing everything twice. Maybe I should sit right in front of that thing so you can't see it twice. Mi, Re and Do. So let's go. We'll do Good News Chariot's Coming using our hand signs. Off we go. Mi, 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 Re, Do, Mi, Re, Re. The hand signs are such a good visual tool for children. Kodai uses relative sol fa, so actually this pattern, Mi Re and Do, we can change it, we can put whatever we like. Mi Re and Do, we can have any key we like. Relative sol fa, Do being the home note of any major key. La being the home note of a minor key, but we might come to that on week two or three. Let's for now just work on Mi, Re and Do. So we have a very useful tool. this hand stave is such a useful tool because it's portable, we can take it wherever we want, and it's a nice step from those hand signs onto the stave. So we can put mi, re and do wherever we want. And if we put it here, where mi is in this second space, mi, re and do, then we can sing it from our hand stave in sol fa. Off we go, mi, 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 re, do, mi, re, re, mi, re, do, mi, 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 re, do, mi, re, re, mi, re, do. But of course it can transpose to a different place as well. We could have sung it anywhere we want to sing it. From the hand stave then, we can put it onto this very child-friendly stave with only one line, just showing where those pitches actually live. Of course, I would ask the children to sing the whole thing, just like you're going to do now. So let's transpose our little melody. Let's say, mi, 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 re, do, mi, let's put it there. But we'll show it in hand signs. Off we go, mi, 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 re, do, mi, re, re, mi, re, do, mi, 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 re, do, mi, re, re, mi, re, do. So actually what we've just seen is just a tiny part of the stave, and of course it needs to go on the whole stave, a normal five-line stave. And the children should then experience it in different positions so that immediately they're aware of movable do. That do is not locked in one place on the stave. Do can be wherever we choose it to be. The important thing though is the relativity of the one pitch to another pitch. That's really what we're working on. That do can be wherever it is, wherever it wants to live, wherever we want it to live. But re will always be a step above, and mi will always be a step above again. So the relativity of the sound. And of course, this hearing this sound first through hand signs, then on the stave, and hearing it in our inner ear is really, really important. So actually, if you hadn't known this melody and you've been introduced to these hand signs, you can begin to hear these things in your head. Why is the development of the inner ear important? Actually, can you imagine if we always saw something that we were going to sing and we had to go always to an instrument to translate it? What we need to do is develop the ability in our head to hear what's on that page before we go to an instrument to play it. Because if we know what the sound is that we're trying to find on whatever instrument we play, then the tuning will be much more accurate. The children will know what the sound is they're trying to achieve. Not only will they know what the sound is they're trying to achieve, they're more likely to play it as if they were singing it. And that development of playing in a singing style, I think, is so crucial that it's not a mechanical, intellectual decoding of something on a page that then becomes a pitch they play on an instrument. Okay, if you play the piano, then it's kind of okay, because on the piano your pitch is made for you and you just have to play that thing. You have no choice over it. The piano tuner will deal with that, not you. But any other instrument, you have to kind of find that sound. And if it's in your head, you're going to find it more accurately. I always think it's a bit like if we looked at words on a page and then we had to go to a typewriter to type in all the letters so that the typewriter could say cat. Well, that would slow down our development of language hugely if we had to type everything to a computer to get those word sounds. The word sounds is in our head, the bank is in our head. And likewise with singing, the singing sounds should be in our head so that we can hear accurately what's on a page. Kodai actually said that we should develop the mini musician first. We should develop the musicianship side of the child's musical education before we give them an instrument. And when I look back on some children learning instruments, it always worries me that so many children give up. You know, I ask them, are you still playing the trumpet? No, I gave it up. Are you still playing the clarinet? No, I gave it up. And actually, it's a lot for a child to learn to decode that thing on the page along with the technicality of whatever instrument they're playing. So we're trying to do two things in one. We're trying to develop the musicianship along with the technical aspect. And actually what sometimes happens is the musicianship gets left behind and we develop a technician. But we don't want to develop a technician, we want to develop a musician. And so that musicianship training should come, I think, before the instrument. And it doesn't mean that we do the musicianship training and then we learn the instrument and we forget the musicianship. It continues to go hand in hand. Musicianship skills we need to learn for the rest of our life, hand in hand with our technical ability on an instrument, so that we develop well-rounded musicians, not just technicians. So this hand signs on the stave is a step towards the blobs on the stave. And the blobs on the stave are kind of a step towards real music. We put the same song that's been in the child's head on the stave. They're not going to get it wrong because it's already planted here. So our first attempts at reading are always successful. So we go from the known in baby steps to the unknown. Always the known material first to feel success, and step by step to the unknown that they begin then to sight read. There's Kodai's, I don't know if you can see that, I hope you can, but this is a Kodai quotation. If one were to attempt to express, the essence of the education in one word, it could only be singing. So we kind of, I started the discussion with singing. I'm finishing the discussion with singing because it is really crucial, not just to Kodai education, I think to music education in general, that we're trying to develop a whole child through the most natural thing we all have, our voice. I'm just looking here to see, has anybody got any questions? Lots of comments, but nobody has any questions. So over the next 2 weeks, my plan is to delve a bit more, go a bit deeper into the solfège learning for our own benefit, because as music teachers, we obviously need to be absolutely happy using these tools ourselves in order to teach them. And to talk a bit more about the sequencing, because the sequencing and the process of learning is so, so important. Moving step by step from the known to the unknown in baby steps. So, learned this in primary school many moons ago, says someone. I have to tell you, so did I. We had the Kirwan modulator on the wall and we did solfa till morning till night. And I just loved it. And it's in my head for the rest of my life. And Lord, may that continue, actually. I'm very happy it is. Thank you very much for tuning in, folks. I hope that's been a bit of an insight into Kodai-inspired education. And I hope to see you all next week again. I'm not seeing any questions. And if I'm not seeing any... somebody has asked, would you use with high school pupils? Absolutely, I would use with high school pupils. And that's another misconception. Thank you very much for the question, Martha. Another misconception, actually, that Kodai inspired education is for young children. Kodai in education is for everyone. And there are many adults that I work with, and I'm sure many adults that a lot of you work with, who, when they arrive at Kodai education for the first time, it's almost like a light bulb moment go on. And that light bulb is the fact that it's given answers to the questions that they had. And I'm a bit in that category myself. why didn't they understand things at school? Oh my goodness, this Kodai thing has made it all so crystal clear. So it's not just for the younger children. It is, however, more challenging in secondary school because you need to find a repertoire that will appeal to that age of child, which is undoubtedly a greater challenge than working with a seven-year-old child. However, it can be done. And with this age group, I would absolutely start with Doremi. Minor melodies, they like singing minor melodies when they're older. Songs in a foreign language, that adds to the challenge. Some of these body percussion games that are quite complex, the older child will absolutely love. So yes, use it with all ages, from cradle to grave. Any other questions? I started Kodai at 15 and it changed my life. Emily Wishart, thank you very much. That's exactly what I want to hear. Thank you, folks. Have a nice night. I hope you're having a great time at the Benedetti Foundation sessions. It's all just so exciting. And I hope to see you next week. Bye.